الرحيم الحمد لله الواحد الأحد الحكيم الصمد الذي كان من عز صفاته أنه لم يلد ولم يولد وعرفنا بوحدانيته بقوله ولم يكن له كفوا أحد والصلاة والسلام على العبد المؤيد الرسول المصدد المصطفى الأمجد المحمود الأحمد أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس والطهر طهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يومنا هذا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا أقسم بهذا البلد وأنت حل بهذا البلد ووالد وما ولد لقد خلقنا الإنسان في كبد صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد.
Dear brothers and sisters in Iman, this is a concluding majlis of series of these 12 majalis of first ashara of Muharramul Haram of 1436th year of Hijra at Baitul Il. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all for your regular participation in this Azadari and these Majalis of Sayyidul Shuhada and his companions, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from you, your families, from all the sponsors, from all the volunteers, from all those brothers and sisters, elderly and young ones, who have played any role in organizing these majalis and in holding these majalis. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all with the best rewards and particularly with the shifaat of Muhammad o Ali Muhammad alayhi salatu wassalam. If you don't mind, particularly the sisters, normally our zakireen, they think their job is only to recite majlis and they shouldn't worry about anything else. But you know that I am not one of those zakireen. So I believe that our religion is a very complete religion and it emphasizes on discipline. Even when we pray, it tells us how to stand and how shoulder to shoulder and how our feet should be next to each other. And when we sit in any gathering, so there are adab and there are ways of sitting together. So far it is fine on the brother's side like that, but as we will see more and more people coming in, we will eventually feel some difficulty in that area. So normally the best way, when you come, so you start sitting from this side. So it's not the very appropriate way to sit in the entrance. And that is something that nobody has to keep telling it forever. So once or twice you tell people, and then you understand that people are reasonable people and they will remember that, and they will also maintain all these things. And for sisters also, we have put almost 2 to 4 to 6 and 8. I personally spread those 8 carpets for sisters last night at 12 o'clock. And we left from here at 12:30. So I was not kind of crazy or kind of out of my mind that working here and spreading these carpets for you at middle of night and then asking you to all just now sit in the doors and next to the, for example, entrances or behind the curtain. So it is organized and it looks good to sit in organized way. And if you are sitting as brothers are sitting in front of each other, this is how we pray together. So nothing wrong with that. Sitting in rows, sitting in front of each other, it creates the environment of majlis, you know. And we are the people that who are sitting in these majalis as very young children, and now we are with gray hairs, and even if today we don't know how to sit properly in any gathering and in any masjid, I don't know what did we learn from these majalis. Recite a salawat. So these are more, to me, these are more important than issues, more important issues to be discussed in these majalis than talking about heavens and earth and talking about that Yazid who passed away 1400 years ago and not addressing the issues of our time and our daily life. So everybody is different. Maybe you will be a little bit disappointed, but I don't beat the lakir or line or only the past. I live in my present and I try to help my other brothers and sisters also to live in present and also be a model community that the Imam of age, when he looks down upon us, he feels proud of us. That is the purpose. That Imam of our age, Imam of our time, he feels proud of us that this is an organized community. This is a community which has nazm, which has zabt, which has discipline, which has order, and this is a community that I am proud of it. Recite a loud salawat. Very quickly, my brothers and sisters, the topic in these 12 days has been the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Balad that we have created human being in stressful conditions, that his life will remain always under pressures and under certain stress and challenges. And this is not by default, this is by design. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed the life of mankind in this world in such a way that all of us have to face pressures, difficulties, challenges, hardships, tests, and trials. And I explained in my previous majalis the wisdom behind it, the benefits we receive from these tests and trials and hardships and difficulties. And we are now concluding the last segment of our presentation, which is that yes, we understand we are being tried, yes, we understand we are in test, but is there any system placed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where we can look for some assistance and help to pass the test and to be able to face these difficulties and these hardships and these pressures which we feel in our life? Because it is not justice and it is not fair to think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts people in hardships and difficulties and then doesn't provide any resources to them that how they can cope with those pressures and with those difficulties. So in this last majlis, we are now focusing on that and concluding that discussion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created humankind with a certain inclination, with a certain nature, and which makes human being a social animal. Insan is from uns. Insan is a being which lives his or her life in groups, in company, in family, in community, in friends, and lives a kind of in a social manner, in a social way. It's a social being, social animal. And one of the reasons to create insan with this nature was, again, with it is consistent with the plan of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to try him and is going to make him face challenges and pressures in his life. So this will make him now to look around, to rally around, and to make friends and make some groups and organizations and institutions and task force to help him or to help her to face all those difficulties and problems and whatever one is going through. So the idea is that yes, as when we get sick, we go to the hospital. So hospital is need, we go to the doctor and then we go to the hospital. If we have physical illnesses, if we have mental illnesses, then we go to those places which are prepared with the professional help for the mental illnesses. By the way, in this time and age, and particularly in the society where we are living, the mental illnesses are also very common in the society. And many people in family and in community, they are in need of those professional helps. But normally, our community behavior is that we think that I will be, or any Muslim member of the community will be the last person to really come across with that kind of situation. So we have a habit of covering under rug or living in a denial and avoiding seeking professional help. And to us, that is a black magic. To us, that is something that we should call at those numbers which we see on desi TV channels or desi akhbars, newspapers, asking Bengali Baba and asking this Baba and that Baba, for example, for Taweez or Dua or Isme Azam or something like that. And we are serving the community on daily basis, and many times I see young members of our community and youth of our community and sometimes the parents of this community, that when they come and seek help from us, basically even we can't help them. Their help is somewhere else. They need to see professional help from the psychiatrist or from a psychologist or they need to visit those special facilities and the hospitals and seek the proper help. And these problems are curable and these problems are treatable. The good thing is that all these things can be treated. But the problem is we live in denial. We don't agree that I have any problem. Well, how come I can have a problem in my stomach, but I cannot have a problem in my head? Meaning, does it make any difference? Meaning, I am a human being. If I can have headache, if I can have backache, and if I can have all those other diseases and all those other problems, how come I cannot have mental problems or I cannot have psychological problems? It's a reality of life. And particularly in a very stressful society where we don't have much kind of care available to us, we are the immigrant group. Immigrant people go through many more pressures than even the local ones. The local ones are used to with weather, with system, with being lonely, with being at their own, and with meaning going through all those kind of pressures and difficulties. That is their normal life. But for people like us who come from totally different society, from different kind of culture, from different value system, we go through a lot. And unfortunately, the culture is such that, as I said, we didn't remain Desi and we didn't become Vilayati. We are now stuck somewhere in between. And we don't feel comfortable for sharing our pains and problems with one another, because now we are too much conscious about this privacy issue, which we were not when we were back home. We would sit in street or in intersection and tell everything to everybody loud, and everybody knew everything about everybody. You know that, huh? But after migrating to this society, we have become very private and very chui mui and very vulnerable kind of people. That we want to have our all life in closed and sealed envelope. Nobody should know anything what I am going through. And then there are issues also. People have reasons to not open up because we are not trained to keep the secrets of people and the problems of people in private. And there are other reasons also. I don't want to expand on that anymore. But my point is that I am speaking with knowledge on this issue. I'm not just guessing. And I had discussions with professionals within community, and they were in agreement with me that Maulana, you should talk from the member and tell the people that people should not live in denial. Particularly these early teen boys and girls who go to middle school and who go to high school, depression is one of very common problem in the middle school and high school age. And we think that no, my child or my son or my daughter has become, God forbid, corrupt or something like fasid or fasik, and we start abusing the child, or we start kind of treating the child in that age in a very negative and very wrong way. without realizing that this child needs professional help. And then again, people in their college age, particularly when they enter in the age of this loneliness and work pressure and college life and academics, and then mother taunting and father hunting and community interviewing every time when you see young men at the masjid, you know that we have a habit of interviewing our young ones, asking them all the details of their life, and the youth born and raised here don't like that. They don't like to be interviewed by everybody and with all those details. So we don't discuss these issues, that we have migrated from one society into another society which has totally different culture and different values and different norms. And one of the barakat and blessing of this farsh of aza of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam, this is a blessing of Imam Hussain, that he brings all these people together for 2 months and 10 days. And this is a good opportunity to talk about the issues, to share the information with one another, to get some good help from the system. And while we discuss the Quran, while we discuss Hadith, while we discuss history, while we discuss theology, while we discuss our aqaid, we should discuss these practical problems of our individuals and our families and our community. Quran doesn't discuss only Shaitan and only Namrud and only Shaddad and only Haman. Quran discusses even being the book of Allah, the revealed book, the best book. The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with the basic issues of everyday life. If you read the Quran, Quran deals with the basic issues of everyday life. And same was the Prophet. Prophet of Islam would sit on the minbar and talk about the current issues and the basic issues faced by individuals and families and the Muslim community at large. Imma, read Nahjul Balagha, open Nahjul Balagha. These are the speeches of Amirul Mu'mineen and the letters of Amirul Mu'mineen. And Amirul Mu'mineen is not only doing this nukta business, that only one nukta to tha nukta to tha nukta, and people are all sitting in front of him and chanting slogans and Narae Haidri and Salawat and doing all that. Amirul Mu'mineen is sitting on the minbar enjoying tha nukta, tha nukta, tha nukta. Amirul Mu'mineen talks about the pains and the problems faced by the community and the society. Read Nahjul Balagha from cover to cover, and how many times he spoke about Khilafat. How many times Amirul Mu'mineen himself speaks about his haq or imamat or khilafat or these issues. And how many times he speaks about these basic issues of you and me going through. But if anybody comes in Muharram and Safar and talks about these issues, he is out of line. Hum to rone ke liye aaye the. We came here to listen to the majlis of Imam Hussain, and he was talking about all those issues which have no relevance with Karbala. Baba, you are not living in Karbala of your time.
Subhanallah, subhanallah.
You are not living in Karbala of your time. Karbala, kullu ardhin Karbala wa kullu yawmin ashura.
Subhanallah, subhanallah.
Every day is Ashur and every land is Karbala. And we need to be practical people. We need to know what is going on. We need to know what we are facing. And then we need to help each other. And we need to come up with system and institutions, services, help, resources, where we are working together, helping each other, uplifting the community, building the community, building the community of Imam-e-Zamana, building the community of Imam of the age, Ajjalallahu Farajahu Sharif.
Allahumma salli ala
So my point, brothers and sisters, is that if there is a hospital, then we have academic needs, we have schools, we have colleges, we have universities, there are organizations, there are services here and there, we know where to go. The issue is, when Allah says that we have created mankind in this particular environment, with this particular nature, that man is always going to be under pressures, facing challenges, going through tests and trials. Did Allah create any solution or help, or he didn't care about that? He said, you just go and figure it out at your own. My job is only to put you in trouble. But how you face the trouble, that is all up to you. But we know Allah is caring Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ra'ufur Rahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Kareem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kind. He is merciful. He cannot leave us just at our own, putting us in trouble and then saying goodbye. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, of course, created a system. Today in this conclusion, I will bring your attention to this one chapter of Quran. It's one chapter, very brief, and all of you have memorized it. I know all of you have memorized. You recite this chapter in your salat. And that chapter actually puts all those resources and all that advice there. First, making again the point, as he says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. Here he says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ. By the way, whenever you read Quran, I'm sending you back with a challenge. You open Quran, do your research at your own. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about mankind, Allah has never spoken in one sentence anywhere in Quran that he is satisfied with this being, or this being, insan, is really a good being. Even anywhere in Quran, wherever he talks about insan, he points out about the weaknesses of insan, the problems created by insan, the shortcomings of insan, the challenges of insan, and all the issues of insan. Take it as a project. Young people who have time, they want to do some research. So you start Quran from Surah Al-Hamd, go until Surah An-Nas. Only one good reference which you can find is لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. But that also is not about insaniyat of insan, it is only about his physical features, or meaning how insan looks like. Other than that, in whole Quran, Allah always criticizes insan, finds out the weaknesses of insan, finds out the shortcomings of insan, and highlights the problems created by insan. Like this, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Wal Asr, Innal Insana Lafi. Allah speaks first for the whole mankind. The whole mankind, the Al Insan, is in loss. Insan khasare mein hai, insan ghate mein hai, insan murad, the whole insaniyat. Then, like everywhere else in Quran, then Allah makes some exception. He opens some class and he says, yes, in general, this is how Al Insan is, but there are few insan, there are few people in mankind that they are exception. They are exception. They are different. They are the true Al Insan. And those are always in a minority. Those were always in small numbers. They are always few people here and there, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes exception for them. Like in this surah, he says, Wal Asr, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Insan is in loss. Insan is in loss. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Four things which can help you to come out from this condition of loss. Make sure that you are in profit, you are gaining, you are succeeding, you are accomplishing, and you are going forward as a successful individual or family or community. But you need these four things. These four things, according to Khaja Nasiruddin Tusi, that if you get into the detail of these four things, it becomes the whole value system of Islam. Once Khaja Nasiruddin Tusi, he made this comment. He said, if the whole Quran is lost, God forbid, and we lose the whole Quran, but we just have if this Suratul Asr in hand, we have not lost anything. This Suratul Asr has everything in it. The whole Quran in concise manner is in Suratul Asr. Four things. One, Al-Iman. The other, Al-Amalu Salih. Third, sticking with the Haqq. First of all, knowing the Haqq, then sticking with Haqq, supporting the Haqq, standing with Haqq,
Subhanallah, Subhanallah.
That, and then watawasaw bis sabr, maintaining the patience and promoting this value and the culture of the patience and perseverance and being persistent and being a person of perseverance and never giving up, never quitting, never abandoning the cause because it is difficult or it is hard. So these are the four values, my brothers and sisters. Because it is a last majlis, sometime I recite the whole ashra on this surah. And if I get into the details, now I need again 12 more majalis. So because I am not planning that, I am in concluding mode. So I am just highlighting. Have a few more comments and we will conclude the majlis. Four things, my brothers and sisters, will help us to face the difficulties, the hardships, the tests, the trials, and the stress which we are facing in our daily life, in family, in business, at work, in relations, in community or in society at large. Four things. Number one, Amanu, Iman. Iman. Iman is, my brothers and sisters, a biggest resource. Faith. Even doctors and these psychiatrists and psychologists, where they feel that now they cannot help anymore, then they look to the clergy. Then they look to the chaplains. Then they look to the faith groups and they say, no, this is your time, that father or pastor or imam, now you come in. And if you preach, if you sit next to them, if you talk to them, it may help them. And they have now stories and some, what they call, studies actually. And these studies are published that where nothing helped, the prayers and supplications helped. There is a time. So faith is a very big resource, my brothers and sisters. Iman. Faith connects you with the center of energy. All energy comes from the source of energy, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Connects you, faith, with the strongest being, supreme being, who is all knowing, all listening, all watching, and all able also. Faith if someone has faith, will never commit the suicide. The person of faith will never quit. Because faith will always keep the hope alive. Because you are connected with someone who is ala kulli shay'in qadir. So one thing what we need to do, my brothers and sisters, to revive our faith, strengthen our faith, and know that my strongest resource, as we every day we make sure that I need to have that much protein. Those who are very health conscious people, they have the pyramid of their diet pyramid, and they know for a person of this age, this height, this weight, this kind of daily routine needs this much protein and this much this and this much this and this much this, and we make sure that in our plate, in our daily menu, we take all those kind of things. So before that, my brothers and sisters, what we need on daily basis is faith, iman. And in order to have the faith, it's not only enough that a person was born in a Muslim family and says La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah and Aliun Waliullah and that's it. It's a constant kind of process of remaining in faith, keeping the faith, strengthening the faith, reviving the faith. And for that reason, the injection of faith, according to hadith, is the Quran, the recitation of Quran, Tilawatul Quran, and then is reading the hadith of Muhammad o Ali Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam. Unfortunately, majority of our people don't know the Arabic or Farsi, and our books are still, majority of those good books and the major books are still in Arabic and Farsi. We are sitting here and we have the honor of presence of Hujjatul Islam, Sheikh Rizwan Arastu, who is committed to translate these books, inshallah, from Arabic and Farsi to English, and he is doing a great job. He has translated so far very ably and very scholarly Usul-e-Kafi, which he is still working on that, but it's a big work. He has translated Dua-e-Nudba, and recently one of the best books which he has, the Emissaries of God. So that is the Lives of Anbiya, which is our role models, the sources of strength and faith. And all what he needs is help and support, that the well-to-do people in the community and everybody in community should feel some responsibility to getting involved, giving whatever you give, little or more, but give on regular basis, sponsor some of the publications, that he and his team can get all these resources translated into our language, and our language, English, is now the language of the whole world, and this language is the language of ilm. This is the language of now information. We need to look at this language as our language, and the language of our time, and language of knowledge and information. And so inshallah, he is, for his sehat o salamti and success of his work, please recite aloud salawat. So the point is, how we can strengthen our iman. We can strengthen our iman by reading. First we need to read. Read Quran, read Hadith, read Akhlaq. The inspiration comes from the inspirational lives of Anbiya and Awliya, A'imma of Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wasalam. When we will read their lives, their examples. Karbala is one of the best stories and one of the best examples of the life of Ahlul Bayt. But Ahlul Bayt have so many Karbalas. We don't know. every imam had his own Karbala. Every imam had his own Karbala. Hazrat Zahra Salamullah Alayha, she had her own Karbala. Imam Mujtaba had his own Karbala. Imam Hussain had his Karbala. And other A'imma had their Karbalas. Imam Ali has his Nahjul Balagha, but then every Masoom has his Nahjul Balagha. Imam Sajjad had his Sahifa Sajjadiya, but then every Masoom has his Sahifa. But we are a community that we don't have access on our resources. So one thing that we need to read. We need to read. Then only reading is not enough. Then comes the application. Whatever we read, now we have to apply. We have to apply. When we will apply in our life, then we will see, we will taste the halawat and the shirini and the mithas and the sweetness of iman. The friendship of Allah, you can only understand when you put your hand in hand of God. And then you travel with your God, putting tawakkul on Him. And then you sit on the roller coaster. And you go through ups and downs of your life. And then when you see that you were lost, and here He comes and He helps you when you had no hope. That is 100 times stronger than chanting Allahu Akbar. You are living the spirit. Imam Sajjad alayhi salatu wassalam, he says that, he gives the example, this knowledge and its application. He says knowledge is like one small lamp on your hand. Whatever you learn, whatever knowledge you have, this is like one lamp put on your hand. You are standing in darkness. Now, this lantern or this whatever this lamp you have at your hand, its light can guide you how far? You are standing here in darkness and here you have a small lamp at your hand. It guides you only for a few steps. All the other side, you see, that is all dark. But if you apply this much, whatever you have, if you walk in these few steps in the light of this lamp, then what will happen? Now you can see a few more steps. And then when you go there again, this is here, now you see a few more steps. So you can go 1,000 miles just with this little lamp. But the shart and condition is that whatever you can see with this lamp, you have to walk. You have to walk. And then it increases and it helps. Same is iman. Iman becomes stagnant. Iman becomes stagnant and finally kind of jamid, which is kind of like... meaning it says, ji? Steady. But when we use it, when we imply it, when we take the challenge, when we do what we are supposed to do in by putting tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and doing all the good homework and the right steps we take and walk in the direction, here iman becomes qawi. Iman becomes stronger. And then we see that now, alhamdulillah, iman is in spirit, it is in life, it is active, and it is getting stronger and stronger. I cannot expand any more on this because of the time. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And then comes وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. No matter how good wishes we have, and how many good intentions we have, and how many good plans we have, and how many good those ideas we have, but those are not going to help you to come out from the loss except you materialize those good intentions and good plans and good wishes in practical life and amelus salihat. When you do good things, it revives your spirit. There is a hadith, by eating only your stomach enjoys, but by feeding others your spirit enjoys. You have wonderful food on your table and you sit alone and you eat the whole thing. So only who is enjoying? Maybe your tongue and your stomach. But you have no spiritual uplift. You don't have high feelings that I have done something good. But you share this food with someone who is desperately in need of that food. And then you see some satisfaction on the face of that miskeen, that faqir, or that needy person, or that friend or relative, feeling happy that you have honored him and honored her, and now you have fed him or fed her and helped her. So what will happen? Now you feel pleasure. Now you feel uplift. Now you feel a ruhani kind of masarrat. So by eating, the pleasure is only for your stomach. But feeding, now you have the pleasure for your soul, pleasure for your mind. Similarly, why volunteers? There are no studies available. The people who volunteer live longer and live healthier life. Why? Because when they volunteer, they have this feeling that they are now part of solution. They are contributors. They are producers. They are helpers. This helps their self-esteem. This heals their spirit. This heals their soul. It gives them positive energy. It gives them good reasons to feel good. And when you feel good and you don't have guilt and you feel that, so it helps you to actually become stronger, not fall sick. Or even if you have small sicknesses, you cure yourself. And the volunteers, they say they live longer. And they live healthier life. But I can be a person that, no, why should I volunteer? Meaning, why? Jo secretary hai, wo khud kare. Jo sadar hai, wo khud kare. Jiske paas chabi hai, wo kare. The person who is in committee, the person who is elected, the person who is very close to Maulana, for example, or the CEO of this organization, this is his headache, her headache. I am not going to do this. Baithe raho bhai tum. Kya fark padta? Somebody else will take care of that. अल्लाह के काम तो कभी नहीं रुके. अल्लाह के काम तो कभी नहीं रुके. तुमने अपने आप को महरूम कर लिया. यू डिप्राइव योर सेल्फ फॉर बींग पार्ट ऑफ समथिंग विच वुड ब्रिंग प्लेजर टू यू एंड हील योर स्पिरिट एंड अपलिफ्ट यू. कभी मस्जिदों के इमाम बाड़ों के इधारों के दरवाजे बंद हो गए एक दो चार आदमी के चले जाने से. लोगों के आने से पहले भी इदारे बने थे और लोगों के चले जाने के बाद भी चलते रहते हैं. एक सलावत पढ़िए बाबा जी. बट द इश्यू इज दैट यू इट इज अ सोर्स ऑफ स्ट्रेंथ. यू गेट कनेक्टेड विद द ग्रुप. यू गेट कनेक्टेड विद कम्युनिटी. यू गेट कनेक्टेड विद लाइक माइंडेड पीपल. You enjoy being with them. You enjoy working with them. And then you feel that I am doing this as Hazrat Ibrahim was building the house of Allah. Putting yourself in the shoes of Ibrahim. Putting yourself in the shoes of Hazrat Ismail. Putting yourself in the shoes of Muhammad Mustafa. Putting yourself in the shoes of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ وَعَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ again purposely Allah didn't now name any amal salih here. Because we all of us, and I know my audience very well, and when I speak sitting from here, I am looking at every face. And being a local member of the community, so since I know individuals also, but even if I don't know individuals in person, This is our experience, and by the way, this is my 36th Ashara. 36 years have passed me reciting Majalis of Muharram. So when we sit here, so we look at every face, and face is index of the heart, and it shows and it tells what's going on. And every one of us has his or her own list of amale sale. Har kisi ka ek apna pick choose karke ek uska banaya hua hai criteria amale sale ka. If I'm not speaking tonight about hijab, then there are number of people in my audience, they say, Maulana ne ki takreer, bekar takreer. Itna bada issue hai hijab ka, qaum mein, community mein. Maulana ne hijab ki ek baat nahi ki. Bekar takreer. Then, if I don't speak about beard, for example, then there are individuals sitting, bekar ki baatein. Itne, this is a very important issue. Kyun nahi baat karte Maulana iske baare mein? Some people are sitting here that to them how to pray in jamaat is the topmost issue. Sari takreer bekar hai agar namaz jamaat ke masail nahi bataye. To some other person, Islamic revolution of Iran, and if I have not spoken about Vilayat Faqih, and if I have not quoted Aye Khamenei 10 times, then Maulana bekar, pura Muharram bekar kar gaya. Kya fayda? Pura 10 din majalis padi Muharram ki, aur janab, jo practical issues the, na Vilayat ka tazkira kiya, na Faqih ka tazkira kiya, na Iran ki koi baat ki, isa purane kisam ke maulvi, bekar. Somebody loves charity, somebody loves ziyarat, somebody loves hajj, somebody loves something else. Somebody loves ziyarat, somebody loves majlis, somebody loves matam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And instead of putting finger on single one thing, he says, wa amilu salihat, as salihat has alif lam, which means all the good actions. That meaning, according to the time, according to the needs, according to the situation, you have to think, you have to plan, and you have to do the right things. But all the right things. You cannot make your own special menu of that amal-e-saleh, pick and choose kind of thing. Al-as-salihat, al-iflam, all the acts of faith, acts of kindness. And then comes very important thing. These were two. Al-amal, al-amalu salih, wa tawasaw bil haq. Insan is created with that nature. That when you come and stick with haq and you support the haq, you actually get the energy. You feel proud. You feel satisfied. And this also eliminates so many depressions and so many discriminations in community and in family and in society. So if everybody enjoins each other about haq and recognizes haq, supports haq, stands with haq, gives sacrifices with haq, then haq becomes strong. And in a family or in a community or in a neighborhood or in a society, if haq is in control, if haq is in control and haq is strong, you know how many, now everybody is crying about that they are not getting their haq, they are not getting their huquq. And when you don't get your own haq, that brings you more down and you feel discriminated and you feel depressed. Why? Because you are not getting your haq. You are not getting your huquq. All this problem of human rights and animal rights and this rights and that rights. We cannot get all those rights and huquq until first we know the haq and then we stand with haq, then we support the haq. We have our own haq and huquq. We have the family haq and hukuk. We have haq and hukuk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Haq and hukuk of anbiya. Haq and hukuk of ahlul bayt. Haq and hukuk of Muhammad wa ali Muhammad and shuhada. Haq and hukuk of Karbala. Haq and hukuk of all those ulama and mujahideen and all those people that who are struggling. All of them, they have haq and hukuk. So if we understand the haq and then we stand with haq, we strengthen the haq, then the system of haq will become in control. When haq is in control, many of those problems which we face, many of those depressions, many of those issues and pressures which we go through, it will become easy to face. This is a big help. And then the last thing, Allah knows the nature of this world and this life better than anybody else. Allah has not created this world as an ideal world. This is not an ideal place. And no matter how much you understand haq and how much you support haq and how much you stand with haq, still, you won't be able to fix everything according to the standards of haq, and this world will never become again a perfect one. And problem-free and pain-free. And then what do you need? No? Sabr. Watawasob is sabr. That, yes, we tried, but it is not ideal place. It is a test. It is a trial. It's a temporary abode. Then when, after doing everything, still we didn't get what we were looking for. So now this is the stage where we have to be sabir, sabr. And sabr, my brothers and sisters, is a biggest resource and biggest help for all the pains and the problems and the sufferings and the depression and whatever you can talk about. That's the biggest resource. In ahadith we have that the biggest resource which mu'mineen have, or the legacy which mu'mineen have from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wassalam, who suffered the most, that is the legacy of sabr. One of the benefits of this Farsh-e Aza and Majalis of Muharram is to teach us how to be patient. And if we come and sit on this Farsh for 2 months and 10 days, and then we are the same panic people and same patientless people and same people that who have no little patience in our daily life, family life, business life or community life, only when we come to Imam Hussain we cry and we talk about patience, and here we go out and we are again the same people. Then, my brothers and sisters, we are not sitting in the madrasa of Imam Hussain with learning attitude. So what we need to do is watawasaw bis sabr. And the point here is they enjoin each other. It's not only that you do sabr. No, you are doing sabr, but your job is also to promote sabr. It's not only that you are at haq or you are supporting haq. Yes, you do that, but you are enjoining others also to come and do haq and do the sabr. So these are the four things, my brothers and sisters, which we take as a resource from Quran, from Ahl Bayt, from this Farsh-e Aza, that when we are going out, we will make sure that we are very rich and very strong in these four resources. The resource of Iman, the resource of Al-Amal Salih, the resource of Haq, the resource of Sabr. And if we can do that with a plan, every individual needs to make a plan, every family needs to make a plan, that how I am going to now work on these four things. How I am going to strengthen, how I am going to increase, how I am going to stick in my daily routines, in my weekly routines, in my monthly and annual routines. Then, my brothers and sisters, we will become the people that when we go through tests and when we go through trials and when we go through hardships, we will be able to, inshallah, manage. We will be able to cope. We will be able to face these problems, and no problem is going to be able to break us or ruin us. And if you want to see the strength of these four things, come and look at Karbala. Has ever any group of people gone through so much? Huh? And if any group would go through all this, what the people of Karbala have gone through, then that group of people would be totally finished, totally out of sense. They would lose their mind, they would lose their balance, they would lose their spirit, they would lose their faith, they would lose their self-respect, their sense of integrity and honor, and they would feel so humiliated and so zaleel and so kuchik and so small and so kind of people that they would be shying away and they would be embarrassed. And this is what all Yazid wanted, and this is all what Ibn Ziyad wanted to do that. But then after going through all that, Zainab stands like that. 72 ki matamdar. Hamare ghar mein ek mayyit aa jaye, shohar ki ya bhai ki ya bete ki, sari zindagi baad wali jo hai wo aahon aur siskiyon ki zindagi hoti. Aur Fatima ki beti ne 72 janaza dekha, aur wo bhi ek din chand ghante ke andar andar. Aur Sayyid-e-Sajjad nahifo nazar jaan, कई दिन का बुखार, तीन दिन की भूख और प्यास, गले में इतना वजनी तौक, हाथों और पैरों में हथकड़ियां और बेड़ियां, और मजाल है कि गर्दन झुकी हुई हो, गर्दन उठी हुई है. जब जाते हैं तो ये नहीं है कि अब वो एम्बेरेस्ड हैं या अपने आप को ये महसूस कर रहे हैं कि इज्जत खत्म हो गई या ऑनर खत्म हो गया. वो कहते हैं इज्जत अल्लाह के हाथ में है, ऑनर अल्लाह के हाथ में है. और कन्फ्रंट करते हैं यजीद और इब्ने ज़ियाद को कि तुम हमारे जवानों को कत्ल करके समझते हो, तूने हमें जलील कर दिया है और तुम अल्लाह के हां मुअज्ज़ज़ हो गए हो. हम शुहदा का खानदान है, हम अंबिया का खानदान है. हमने तो वही कुछ किया जो अब तक 124,000 अंबिया करता चला आया है. और जैसे उन सब मसाइब से गुजर के आज भी वो अंबिया अजीम हैं, इसी तरह से हम भी अजीम हैं और हम अजीम रहेंगे. क्या उनकी हिम्मत कम हुई, जज्बा कम हुआ, अब वो जहनी मरीज हो गए, बोलना बंद कर दिया उन्होंने, प्रोटेस्ट करना बंद कर दिया, कन्फ्रंट करना बंद कर दिया, उसूलों पे कंप्रोमाइज कर गए, कदरें बदल ली, वैल्यूज बदल ली. इतने सारे मसाइब से गुजरने के बाद वही फातिमा की बेटी, अली की बेटी, हुसैन का बेटा, और वो तो बड़े हैं, यहां छोटी सी बच्ची जो है 3 साल की भी, किसी ने उसको दस्ते सवाल आगे बढ़ाते हुए नहीं देखा. भूख लगी थी, प्यास लगी थी, और जब पानी आया था ना, तो कहते हैं कि हुर की बीवी को उमर साद ने कुछ पानी दिया था कि अब तो ये सब कुछ हो गया, ये प्यासे हैं. ये गालिबन 11 तारीख का वाकया है, और ये पानी ले जाओ, दे दो. जब ये पानी आया, अब देखिए ये प्यासे हैं, और कब के प्यासे हैं, कोई और होता तो पानी जैसे ही आता लपक के आगे जाता. पानी आया, सब ने कहा कि ले जाओ इसे वापस, हमें इस पानी की जरूरत नहीं है. जब हुसैन प्यासे मार दिए गए और तड़प तड़प के मर गए, और मेरा अकबर प्यासा मर गया, मेरा कासिम प्यासा मर गया, मैंने पानी को क्या करना है, नहीं चाहिए हमें पानी. बहुत रोई बीबियां याद कर करके प्यास अपने प्यारों की. जब हुर की बीवी जो कि आई थी और उसका कुछ हक भी था अहले बैत पे, इसलिए बीबियां उसको भाभी करके खिताब कर रही थी, तो जब उसने बहुत इसरार किया कि बीबी आप खुद नहीं अभी पीती, तो कम से कम बच्चे प्यासे हैं, आप बच्चों को पिला दीजिए। सकीना बैठी हैं, छोटी सी बच्ची हैं, प्यासी हैं। पानी का प्याला भर के जनाबे सकीना को दिया गया। आपको मालूम है सकीना ने क्या किया था? पानी का प्याला हाथ में उठाया और यूं चल दी मकतल की तरफ। सकीना बेटे, पानी लेके कहां जा रही हो? कहा मुझे पानी क्यों दिया आपने? सबसे पहले कहा इसलिए कि तुम सबसे छोटी हो। जब घर में कोई नई चीज आती है, अहले बैत के लिए पानी नई चीज हो गया था करबला में, जब घर में कोई नई चीज आती है तो सबसे पहले बच्चों को दी जाती है। कहा अच्छा, अगर मैं सबसे छोटी हूं तो मेरा असगर तो मुझसे भी छोटा। मैं चल के अली असगर की तुर्बत पे, कब्र पे ये पानी गिराना चाहती हूं। मेरे भाई सकीना को पानी अब मिला है। अजीजाने गिरामी, ये हिम्मत, ये सलाबत, ये किरदार, ये सब्र जो है, ये अहले बैत का है। और मजाल है कि उनके पाए सवात में लग्जश आई हो। एक मर्तबा 12 का ये वाकया है, तय हुआ उमर साद ने कि इनको, बीबियों को, बच्चों को कैद करके अब कूफा ले जाया जाए इब्ने जियाद के पास। लिहाजा बीबियों के बाजुओं में रस्सियां बांधी गईं और सैयद सज्जाद के गले में तौक डाला गया, हाथों में हथकड़ियां, पैरों में बेड़ियां, ऊंटों पर सवार किया गया। और फिर उसके बाद जब इनको चलाया गया है ना, तो दो तरह की रिवायतें हैं। एक में यह है कि अहले बैत की अपनी ख्वाहिश थी कि जाते जाते अपने वारिसों से विदा करती जाएं और कहा कि हमें कूफा लेके जाओ तो हमें मकतल में से गुजार के लेके जाओ कि हम जाते जाते सलाम आखिर कर लें अपने शुहदा को और अपने वारिसों को। एक रिवायत में यह है कि नहीं, ये फैसला खुद उन्होंने किया था इनको सताने के लिए और इनको डराने के लिए कि ये जाते जाते एक मंजर एक दफ़ा फिर देख लें, जब वो कटे हुए लाशें और जब वो कटे हुए सर और जब वो सारा ब्लड पड़ा हुआ और वो मंजर देखेंगे तो इनके दिल दहल जाएंगे और जब ये जाएंगे कूफा में तो डरे हुए होंगे। जो भी सूरत थी, बहरहाल इतना है कि जब मक्तल में से इनको गुजारा गया है तो एक मर्तबा बीबियों ने कहा कि अब जब हम यहां आए हैं तो हमें नीचे उतारो, हम अपने वारिसों से विदा करना चाहते हैं। बाज रिवायतों में मिलता है कि जैनब ने ऊंट के पूरी तरह बैठने का इंतजार नहीं किया और आई हैं और आके अपने भाई की लाश से लिपट गई हैं। और फिर एक जुमला कहा था जैनब ने, बड़ा दर्दनाक जुमरा है, आके भाई की लाश पे हाथ रखा और कहा कि अंत अखी हुसैन। चूंकि अब जो हालत थी मौला की वो को पहचाने जाने वाली नहीं थी, कहा क्या आप ही हैं मेरे भाई हुसैन, अंत अखी हुसैन। और फिर उसके बाद मुंह मुड़ गया बीबी का मदीना की तरफ और कहा नाना आइए जरा एक निगाह देखिए, ये वही हुसैन है जिसकी आप नाज बरदारियां करते थे, जो आपकी गोद में पला, जो आपकी पुश्त पे बैठा, आइए जरा देखिए, बंद जोड़ हिल चुके हैं, सर कट चुका है, जिस्म जो है पूरा नाजनीन जख्मों से भरा हुआ है, ये वही हुसैन है जिसका अब कोई जोड़ बंद जिस्म का सलामत नहीं रहा। बाकी बीबियां भी गईं, रोई एक एक लाश के पास, कहते हैं दो लाशें वहां पे ऐसे पड़े थे कि जिनके सर पे कोई रोने वाला नहीं था। रावी कहता है कि मैंने सवाल किया कि क्या ये दो बच्चे जो हैं ये यतीम हैं, क्या इनका कोई वली वारिस यहां नहीं है? हर लाश के सिरहाने कोई बीबी बैठी है जो गिरिया कर रही है, ये दो बच्चे इनका रोने वाला नहीं है, ये यतीम है। बस यतीमी का नाम सुनना था, जैनब तड़प गई और जवाब दे के कहा कि नहीं, यतीम तो नहीं है, इनकी कोख जली मां यही मौजूद है। लेकिन अब जैनब करे क्या, जाके भाई को रोए, अपने भतीजों को रोए, या चल के अपने बेटों को रोए? बेटे मेरे ही हैं, लेकिन मुझे अली अकबर से रोने से फुर्सत मिले, हुसैन पे रोने से फुर्सत मिले तो मैं जाके औनो मोहम्मद के सिरहाने बैठूं। बीबियां गिरिया कर चुकी, रो चुकी, रो रही थी कि जालिम आए ताजियाना लेके और उन्होंने कहा कि आप सवार हो जाओ दोबारा ऊंटों पे, देर हो रही है, हमें जाना है। बताया ये जाता है कि बीबियों ने अभी तक कोई इमोशनल जो हालत थी इस किस्म की थी कि उठने के लिए तैयार नहीं थी, बैठ के अभी मजीद गिरिया करना चाहती हैं, मातम करना चाहती हैं कि जालिम ने ताजियाना हवा में हिलाया और बीमार की पुश्त पे कुछ लकीरें इस तरह की उसने खींची आके ताजियाने से कि एक मर्तबा ज़ैनब उठ पड़ी और कहने लगी मेरा बेटा उठ पर, अब हम बैठ के अब इससे ज्यादा हम नहीं देख सकते। उठती हैं ज़ैनब, उठती हैं बीबियां, अब ऊंटों पे सवार होती हैं। अजीजों, इन बीबियों के हाथ पीछे बंधे हुए थे, इन बीबियों के हाथ पीछे बंधे हुए थे और इनको ऊंटों पे बिठा दिया गया, छोटे छोटे बच्चे भी साथ बिठाए गए। अब बच्चे जो हैं उनके बैठने की सूरत क्या थी, उन्होंने दामन, मां के दामन को यूं हाथ से पकड़ा हुआ था, ऊंट पे बैठे हुए हो और बैठने की कोई जगह ना हो सही और माओ के आपने सिर्फ दामन पकड़े हो। बच्चे थक जाते थे, हाथ थक जाते थे, बच्चा गिर जाता था, अम्मा मैं गिर रहा हूं, अम्मा मैं गिर गया हूं, अम्मा मेरे हाथों में सकत नहीं रही है। माएं इस पोजीशन में नहीं थी, इस काबिल नहीं थी कि उनको संभाल के बैठती। अजीजों, इस तरह से ये काफिला चलते चलते ये कूफा में पहुंचता है, कूफा में पहुंचता है। अजीजा ने गिरामी, उधर जब ये कूफा में पहुंचा, अभी उसका एक मंजर आपकी खिदमत में पेश करता हूं। यहां पे एक महल्ला एक कबीला रहता था बनी असद के नाम से, यही करबला के आसपास। और जब उन्होंने देखा कि अब यहां से लोग सारे चले गए हैं, उनकी औरतें और उनके बच्चे आए और उन्होंने देखा कि यहां पे मंजर क्या है, जब औरतें और बच्चे आए और उन्होंने मंजर देखा कि खून ही खून है, लाशें ही लाशें हैं, तो वो पलट के गए अपने अपने मर्दों के पास और उन्होंने कहा कि अगर तुमने पहले मदद नहीं की है हुसैन की तो कम अज कम इतनी मदद कर दो कि आप सारे चले गए हैं, अब इन मैयतों को दफना ही दो, ये बेवारिस पड़ी हुई मैयतें हैं, चल के इनको दफनाओ। बनी असद वाले आए बेलचे हाथों में लिए हुए, उन्होंने आके कब्रें तो खोद ली मगर अब उनको ये नहीं पता चल रहा कि ये कब्र, ये मैयत जो है ये किसकी है, ये हाथ किस मैयत का है, ये पैर किस मैयत का है, किस मैयत को कहां दफन करना है। ऐसे में अचानक जैसे हथकड़ी होके हिलने की आवाज आती है, मुड़ के देखते हैं एक बीमार है खड़ा हुआ, हाथों में हथकड़ियां हैं पहनी हुई, पैरों में बेड़ियां हैं, आके आंखों में आंसू हैं और पूछते हैं आप कौन हैं, कहा मैं वारिस हूं और आ गया हूं, ये मेरे ही बाबा और मेरे ही भाइयों की मैयतें पड़ी हैं, अल्लाह तुम्हें जजाए खैर दे बनी असद, आओ मैं तुम्हें बताऊं मेरे बाबा को कहां दफन करो, मेरे जवान को कहां दफन करो, मेरे छोटे को कहां दफन करो। एक मर्तबा ज़ैनुल आबिदीन ने उनकी रहनुमाई की, खुद नमाज पढ़ी, इन कब्रों को वहां पे दफन करवाया और फिर उसके बाद बएजाज़े इमामत इमाम वापस कूफा में पहुंचते हैं। अजीजों, कूफा के अंदर जो बीबियां दाखिल होती हैं ना 12 तारीख को, खुदा किसी जाने पहचाने लोगों से वास्ता ना डाले, जब इंसान इतनी मुसीबत में हो, जब इंसान इतनी मुसीबत में हो तो उसकी ख्वाहिश होती है कि कोई जानने वाला ना देख ले, कोई जानने वाला ना देख ले। और बीबियां इस शहर की शहजादियां रह चुकी हैं, इस शहर की शहजादियां रह चुकी हैं, कूफा ज़ैनब को जानता है और ज़ैनब कूफा को जानती हैं। अजीजों, जब शहर के अंदर दाखिल हो गई, बस यही रिवायत पढ़ के मजलिस खत्म कर रहा हूं, जब शहर में दाखिल हो गई ना और ऊंटों पे सवार हैं और जा रहे हैं, कूफा की औरतें छतों के ऊपर बैठी हैं, छतों के ऊपर बैठी हैं और मंजर देख रही हैं, कुछ जानती और पहचानती हैं और कुछ तसव्वुर भी नहीं कर सकती कि अली की बेटियां और अब्बास की बहनें और हुसैन की बहनें और हुसैन के ये बच्चे होंगे, उन्होंने कुछ और समझा, छतों पे आके बैठ गई। जब एक औरत ने देखा ना वहां पे जनाबे सकीना को उस आलम में कि जब कुर्ता जला हुआ था, कान फटे हुए थे, चेहरा जो है वो नीला हो चुका था, बच्ची को जब इस हालत में देखा है, बच्ची बहुत भूखी भी लग रही थी, बच्ची बहुत प्यासी भी लग रही थी, एक औरत ने जल्दी से अपनी बच्ची से कहा कि जाओ जल्दी से पानी का एक प्याला लाओ और कुछ खजूरें लाओ, मैंने सुन रखा है कि अगर कैदियों को पानी पिलाया जाए और उनको कुछ खाना दिया जाए और उनसे कोई दुआ करवा ली जाए और वो दुआ कर दे किसी के हक حق میں وہ دعا اللہ قبول کرتا ہے. اس عورت نے اپنی بچی کو کہا پانی لاؤ, وہ پانی لائی, وہ خرمہ لائی, اور اس نے ایک مرتبہ آگے بڑھا دیا اور جناب امام حسین کی اس یتیم بیٹی کے سامنے اور کہا کہ اے بچی میں تمہیں پانی پلانا چاہتی ہوں, میں لگتا ہے تو بھوکی ہے, تو پیاسی ہے, میں تجھے یہ چند خرمہ کے دانے دینا چاہتی ہوں, لیکن میں اس سے پہلے کہ تو یہ کھا لے میرے لیے ایک دعا کر دے, میں دعا کروانا چاہتی ہوں. ایک مرتبہ زینب نے دیکھا اور سکینہ سے کہا بیٹے پانی پینے سے پہلے, کھجوریں کھانے سے پہلے پہلے اس بی بی سے پوچھ لے اس کی دعا کیا ہے اور یہ دعا کیا کروانا چاہتی ہے. ایک مرتبہ پوچھا, اس بی بی نے کہا کہ پہلی دعا تو یہ ہے کہ جس طرح تم لٹے ہو اس طرح میرا خاندان نہ لٹے کبھی. جو اس وقت تمہارے ساتھ بیتی ہے بی بی دعا کر میری آل اولاد کے ساتھ کبھی اس قسم کا حادثہ نہ ہو. زینب نے کہا بی بی آمین کہہ دے, بی بی سکینہ آمین کہہ دے کہ خدا اس کی اولاد کو کبھی اس صدمہ یتیمی سے دوچار نہ کرے. بی بی تیری دوسری دعا کیا ہے؟ کہا میری دوسری دعا یہ ہے کہ میں مدینہ جانا چاہتی ہوں, میں زیارت کے لیے جانا چاہتی ہوں, میرے لیے دعا کر دے, میں کئی سالوں سے تیار ہو رہی ہوں, جا نہیں پا رہی, مدینہ جانے کا میرا خواب پورا ہو جائے, میں زیارت کو جاؤں. بی بی نے پوچھا بی بی مدینہ جا کے کیا کرے گی, مدینہ کیوں جانا چاہتی ہے؟ کہا مدینہ میں میری شہزادی رہتی, مدینہ میں میرے مولا رہتے, میں اپنے مولا کو سلام کرنے, ان کی زیارت کرنے, اپنی شہزادی کو ملنے کے لیے جانا چاہتی ہوں. ایک مرتبہ جب زینب نے یہ سنا نا تو کہا, وہ ایک مرتبہ کہا کہ اچھا تیری شہزادی کا نام کیا ہے؟ کہا اس بھرے بازار میں جب لوگ سارے سن رہے ہو تم مجھ سے میری شہزادی کا نام پوچھتی ہے. ایک مرتبہ کہا بتا دے, آہستہ سے بتا دے. کہا میری شہزادی کا نام زینب ہے, میری شہزادی کا نام زینب ہے اور میں زینب کو ملنے جانا چاہتی ہوں. ایک مرتبہ پلٹ کے کہا بی بی نے کہ اگر زینب کو دیکھ لو تو زینب کو پہچان لو گی. کہا کیسے ہو سکتا ہے, نہیں ہو سکتا کہ میں زینب کو نہیں پہچانوں, میں تو ان کے گھر کی کنیز تھی, میں ان کی شاگرد تھی, میں نے تو قرآن سیکھا ہے ان سے, میں نے تو احکام سیکھے ہیں, میری آقا زادی اور میں نہ پہچانوں. بس ایک مرتبہ یہ سننا تھا, زینب نے چہرے سے بالوں کو ہٹایا اور خطاب کر کے کہا او ام حبیبہ آج تو زینب کو نہیں پہچان سکی اور زینب تیرے سامنے بیٹھی ہے اور وہ جو نوکے نیزہ پہ کٹا ہوا سر ہے وہ تیرے مولا حسین کا سر.